How is everyone doing on this beautiful day? Thank you for joining us this morning as we worship our risen Lord. And this is a day that the Lord has made, so there's reason to rejoice. Amen? Amen. So let's stand together and rejoice in song and praise as we sing "This is the Day" and then "This is Amazing Grace."
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it. Whether the sun will shine, whether the skies will rain, I know that you are good. This is the day you made. Whether in life or death, whether in joy or pain, I know this truth remains, that this is the day you made. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it. Now I can walk in faith, you will protect my way. Your every work is good, and this is the day you made. I am a child of yours, you are the one who saves. I am redeemed by love, this is the day you made. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. And be glad in it. This is the day, come and sing your praise, for the Lord now reigns on the throne of grace. Soon is the day he will bring us home, and we have this hope, for we are his own.
Sing that again.
This is the day, come and sing your praise, for the Lord now reigns on the throne of grace. Soon is the day he will bring us home, and we have his hope, for we are his own. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. And be glad in it. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty, so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings,
who shakes the whole earth,
who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear
it out.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
He is worthy.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. You would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. You can have a seat.
Should have brought sunglasses. Good morning. Just like last week, if anyone has their booklets and needs stamps, after the service, I'll be at the table to stamp them. I don't think I asked this last week, but have any of the kids memorized the monthly Bible verse? You've memorized it? Do you want to come up and say it for us? Okay, come over here. Maybe next time. Good. You're so brave to actually come up, though, so thank you for that. Theo, why are you looking at me? You memorized it?
I didn't hear it.
You didn't hear it. There is a little card in there that I will give to you after, but the monthly verse is Psalm 119, verse 105. No, I'm going to say it. All right. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light on my path. Theo. Hey, Theo. I was telling you the verse. You ready? Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light on my path. Think you can remember that for next week? You've already forgotten it? Okay, I'll give you a card after and you can memorize it, all right? Okay, so that is our monthly verse. If everybody has their Bibles, we will turn to the page. Otherwise, if you need a Bible, Bibles are in the front. And once you find the Bible, which I'm about to tell you the passage, raise your hand and you will get a treat. So it is Acts 2, verse 42. Acts 2, verse 42. Yeah, Acts 2, verse 42. You got Where are the treats? Acts 2, verse 42. Elia has her hand up. We got another one over here. It's okay. No worry. All right. I'm going to start reading. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Now, before I talk about that, what are some habits that you guys do every day, specifically the kids? What's a habit that you do every day? I can't see you, Elia. Is your hand up? Brush your teeth, is that what you said? That's a great one. Yep, I brush my teeth too every day. Anything else? Boaz. Go to sleep? Yeah. So why do we brush our teeth and go to sleep? Take care of what? Yeah? Take care of your teeth? Yep. What are your teeth on? Your gums? Yep. To take care of your body, right? You're taking care of your body. How many of you guys are in school in September? Hands up. You're in school? Why do we go to school? Take care of what? To learn, take care of our brains, right? How many of you guys read the Bible every day? Why do we read the Bible, Elia? To learn about Jesus, right? So if we brush our teeth to take care of our body, and we go to school to take care of our brain, then I think it's safe to say that we read our Bible to take care of our souls, right? Who's heard the term devotion before? Okay, so in the passage we read, it said they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship. So they made time each day to focus on this because they thought it was important. So for us, doing devotions, reading your Bible every day, or reading a book that has little scripture verses, or even just memorizing Bible verses that we have been doing, that is a time that you can dedicate to God and devote to God to help your souls. So to relate to our monthly verse, which is your word is a lamp to my feet and a light on my path, the only way that God's word can guide you is if you're reading it every day. So I challenge you guys to pick a time each day to read your Bible. Usually people do it the morning or the night. I do it in the morning because I'm too tired at night. And then I just say, yeah, I'll do it tomorrow. And then I fall asleep. And I never read it. So I read it every morning. And just like we've been doing the past few weeks about asking questions about the Bible and making a habit of reading it, I think that that's something that we should do so that we're able to understand and learn new things about God each day. So I challenge you guys, looking at the kids, to pick a time. And I'm going to ask you next week, what's your Bible time? What time did you pick? Okay? All right. Thanks.
Thanks, Michaela. Appreciate that. And yeah, love the opportunity that we give for everybody to understand that God's word is for everybody and there's something for us to learn. And so as parents, as you take time to come alongside your kids, that's valuable for you to express that. But even more valuable is to model that. And thankful that we can look up and down generations to do so. You know, as we gather this morning, over the course of the last couple of weeks, I think as we just take some time to pray, I want to read a verse for you. But there's been a couple of storms pass through here over the last couple of weeks, and a lot of people have dealt with some difficulty, some unanticipated and unwelcomed circumstances with water and trees and the like. In fact, Lila's house. They just got their power on last night after a number of days. So that area south of the or north of the highway between Colburn and Murphy was particularly hard hit. And so for those of you who live in that area, in particular this past week, there was a significant number of amount of damage there. And so it's mindful. It's good for us to be mindful of that, and to for those who might have connections in those areas. To make sure that we are extending ourselves to offer help where necessary, and thankful for God's protection amid all the craziness. And certainly recovery and those kinds of things takes time and effort and energy, and so we need to continually encourage and pray for one another and our friends and neighbors in that as well. I want to read for you these verses, and we're going to take some time. I'm going to invite you to to pray with me as we remember the DaCosta serving in Kenya, and they're going into their last full week of working with the kids who are there with their parents, training to be global workers in various African countries. And so this is their last full week of that. Then they have a couple more weeks of some personal time. So we want them to finish well. I want to pray that they finish well as they do. We want to continue to pray for Erin Johns as she serves at Camp Mishawa with Jonah and Nathan Daly, as well as Will Archer serving at Fairhaven's camp. And just ask that God would to sustain them. They're kind of in the middle of their summer. Will's kind of two-thirds of the way through the time that he's been away. And so it's hot. It's repetitive. There's a lot of things that transpire, and so energy and enthusiasm are often valued and hard to come by as camp season goes on. And so it's important for us to be able to pray for them that God would be their strength when their own strength can seem lacking at times. Anybody ever feel that way? That your own strength feels lacking? Occasionally, perhaps. Yeah, perhaps that's true. And so I read these verses from Psalm 91 for us. It says, "Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare, from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys the midday." And so we are reminded that God is our source of strength, that God is our refuge, that God is the one in whom we find shelter. And so I want you to just, as we go to prayer, invite you even to close your eyes for a moment and think back even over the course of this week. And as you think back over the course of this week, consider who or how God has demonstrated His care and protection over you. Maybe it was in an action. Maybe it was in something that didn't happen. Maybe it was in the kindness of somebody else extended to you. There is a way in which God has demonstrated His care for you over the course of this week. As you ask Him to bring that to mind, then return thanks, for He has come into the rhythm of your daily life to remind you that He is there. So, Father, as we pause and give thanks for Your care over us, the tenderness by which You invite us and You commit to caring for us. Often in our hurried lives, we forget that. And so would You forgive us for that, and thank You for just this time to pause and remember that You indeed have provided care. And not even just this week, if we had time to reflect longer and wider, we would recognize Your care over us over the course of many, many days and months and years. So we give You praise and thankful for the tangible evidence of Your love for us. We pray for those who serve in different places, representative of You and representative of our church family. We ask God that You would be their stronghold, that You would renew them here in the midst of summer, in the heat of summer, that You would encourage them, and that You would bring tangible reminders to them that You are caring for them. So we pray for the DaCosta family, that they would finish well as they serve these children, for these families who are learning and desire to serve You with their lives. God, these are building block weeks in these kids' lives. And so would You use the DaCostas to demonstrate the love of God toward them. And for Will, and for Aaron, and for Jonah, and for Nathan, God, as they go through this summer and they kind of hit this threshold, this midway point, God, would You bring encouragement to them? We thank You for their willingness to go and to serve, and we ask, God, that You would renew their strength as well. Watch over them, protect them, Father, so that they may be further used to extend Your grace to others. And we pray for our community as it recovers from these last couple of weeks of high winds and storms and rains. Father, there's much that comes with that. People's patience wear thin. And we pray, God, that You would also be mindful of those who need help and make us mindful of that, that we might extend to them relief and help that they might need. So would You bless our community in these days as well? Thank You again for the freedom that You give to us to celebrate Jesus here in these places, to lift up His name through song, to open His word, to open Your word, Lord, and to learn about You. We thank you for that freedom that you give to us. May we not use that freedom haphazardly, but God, may we take what we learn for your glory as we extend it here further in our community. So we commit to you our lives. We commit to you those whom you have used to bless us and remind us of your presence. We commit to you those who serve. And we ask, God, that you would teach us all the more what it means to follow Jesus. And we pray in his name. Amen.
All right, if you're able, will you stand with us as we continue to sing For Our Sake, followed by Mighty to Save.
Sound praise, hallelujah, to the one who for joy endured the cross for our sake. Love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world. Save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Amen. You can have a seat.
Our thanks to Pat and Sandra for leading us this morning. Let's show our appreciation to them. It's good to be outside. Last week, somebody asked me whether if I really like doing these things outside. I love them. I love them. And here's a couple reasons why. One is, remember like the second Sunday in July when it rained and we had to go inside? Some of you were here for that. And what happened when we went inside? Those who were here sat in the places that they always sat in, even though we went inside. So what I love about being out here is it's all mixed up. There's no seating plan for you. And some of you come early. You can actually come early so that you can get in shady spots. So that's an interesting thing. You sit beside, people who you normally connect with if we were inside. And the third reason is today, snow cones. There we go. The idea of just lingering a little longer and hanging out and getting to know some people and just taking some time to connect, I really, really enjoy that. So, and then the other benefit for that is there are so many people who serve on a regular basis, Sunday to Sunday, the rest of the year, whether that's in our children's ministry or in other places. And so this gives a lot of them the opportunity to have a little bit of a break as well. And so we're thankful for that. And so look for opportunities for you to serve again coming up as we move into August and in particular in September. We're going to be in Psalm 31 today. And if you want to get that out, that would be great. And as you do, as you get that out, let me ask you this question. Raise your hand if you have ever used an escalator or an elevator. Has anybody ever used an escalator or an elevator? Elevator? I heard that elevator back there. All right. You did? Was it fun? Did you do it backwards? Oh, it's the best. When your parents aren't with you. Are with you. Or maybe not with you. I don't know. So, did you know that it's widely considered true that the equivalent of the world's population uses an escalator or an elevator every 3 days? That means 3 days from now, there will have been 7 billion trips up and down escalators or elevators. Now, I know what you're thinking. Sarnia is not contributing a whole lot to that number, right? But there are other places in the world that have bigger buildings than we do. The other thing that is true, in this 21st century, we don't give a whole lot of thought to the significance of moving around on an escalator or an elevator. But it hasn't always been that way. Back in the mid-1800s, there was efforts being made in various parts of the world to advance a new field of transportation called vertical technology. And if you were to go to any city around the world at that time, most buildings would be less than 5 stories tall. Many of them would cap out at 3, kind of like Sarnia. And to get from one floor to another, you had to use, ready? Brace yourself for this information, stairs. You had to climb stairs up and down. But along came a man with an unquenchable desire to try and fail and try again. His name was Elisha. No, not that Elisha. The truth is, you won't likely recognize him by his first name, but his last name might bring instant recognition for many of you. Otis. Elisha Graves Otis was born in 1811, and he would die of sickness before he reached the age of 50. And despite the relative brevity of his life, his influence has transformed the way we build our cities and the way we move within them. How did he do that? More on that in a little bit. Why did he do it is really important for us. Well beyond the need and possibility, he took time to understand the apprehension that people had. Could they trust in this vertical technology? Would they be protected as they moved up and down? And would it be strong enough to hold them? And so as we turn our attention to the Word of God today, we're asking the Lord to teach us from Psalm 31. It's a song and a prayer written by David, and it helps address those same questions. Can we trust God? Will God protect us? Is God strong enough? Now, in the English Bible, the English version of the Bible that I use most often, these first four verses of Psalm 31 sound like this. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set for me, for you are my refuge. Now, if you were listening as I read that, you would have heard that word, refuge, several times. In fact, three distinct instances is it mentioned in the English version of the NIV translation of the in English. But it's not. If you have a different version in front of you, you might notice some different words that are substituted in there, all of which are ascribed to God himself. In other English versions, there are differences in these wordings. This is because of the different original words that were used when David first wrote this. But they all share this common factor of refuge, and that's why it's translated that way for us. Words like trust, fortress, and strength, you might see that on the pages in front of you, are sometimes used in the place of this word refuge. All three of these words in their original language can also be translated as refuge and can be found in other places of Scripture written that way. Together, they expand our idea of what it means that God is our refuge. And certainly, if David had times where he wavered in his ability to trust or felt vulnerable or weak, then we also might be able to identify with him as we experience those feelings. And certainly, as we follow this psalm through, we recognize that even as David makes this declaration of allegiance to God in verse 1, in Lord, O Lord, in you I trust, and after he admits his need for refuge in verses 2 to 4, he makes this commitment, he affirms his commitment with his desire to submit his will to God's will. And we see that in verse 5. He says, into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God. And so after these important, very important initial utterances, something else is revealed within him. And maybe this happens to you sometimes. In verses 6 to 7, there's words of confession that he speaks to God. And this is so important for us to understand that as we submit our desire to the sovereignty of God, we will continually combat our human nature, our prideful thoughts, our instinctive, reactive desires. Because there are shadows of darkness that can only be overcome through the continual surrender to the lordship of Jesus in our lives. This is how the psalmist reveals what's going on within him. He says, I hate those who cling to worthless idols. As for me, I trust in the Lord. I'll be glad and rejoice in your love, for you saw my affliction and you knew the anguish of my soul. And then in verse 8, he reminds himself, almost like he's trying to make this tangible movement to create distance between the negative thoughts that he's thinking about. It's like he's trying to switch directions. He says, you have not given me, in verse 8, you have not given me into the hands of the enemy, but you have set my feet in a spacious place. I don't know about you, but as I read and reread these verses, and it's like this feeling that David knows how close he is to being drawn away, to being overcome because of the pressures that surround him. It's like he has a sense of how easy it could be to just settle into hate and wallow in the darkness of self-pity. There's a part of him that knows that the hands of the enemy are clutching at him. And so he needs to make a tangible move to place himself on the platform of God, in the spaciousness of the refuge of God, so that he would be safe. And as you continue to read through this psalm, this idea of a lack of trust, of feeling vulnerable, of needing the strength of God becomes the biggest emphasis. As David empties himself of his prideful thoughts and he acknowledges his fears and his own inhibitions. Regarding his lack of trust, David continues in verse 9 where he says, "Be merciful to me, Lord, for I am in distress. My eyes grow weak with sorrow, my soul and body with grief. My life is consumed by anguish and my years by groaning. My strength fails because of my affliction and my bones grow weak. Because of all my enemies, I am the utter contempt of my neighbors and an object of dread to my closest friends. Those who see me on the street flee from me. I am forgotten as though I were dead. I have become like broken pottery. For I hear many whispering, terror on every side. They conspire against me and they plot to take my life." Sometimes when things start to overwhelm us, we can make them seem bigger than perhaps they really are. In verse 14, then, it becomes a very significant transition where David redeclares his need for God. See, there are circumstances that are distracting him, and if they're left unattended, they can take away his ability to live faithfully for God, and they could negatively influence the way he treats others. He then sets out not just speaking, but he writes these things down, kind of like ancient sticky notes by which we have the benefit of, or like little reminder notifications that may have been placed in strategic places, popping up as he went through his day. He says, "But I trust in you, Lord. I say you are my God. My times are in your hands. Deliver me from the hands of my enemies, from those who pursue me. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me in your unfailing love. Let me not be put to shame, Lord, for I have cried out to you. But let the wicked be put to shame and be silent in the realm of the dead. Let their lying lips be silent, for with pride and contempt they speak arrogantly against the righteous." David's declaration of trust includes the outcome and length of his life, as well as the circumstances that he was facing. This is a conversation between him and God, and in so doing, he's able to be vulnerable, humble, releasing control to God. And so it's important then to continue to listen in verses 19 and 20. It's where he pauses and reflects, and he says, "But how abundant are the good things that you have stored up for those who fear you, that you bestow in the sight of all. In the shelter of your presence, you hide them from all human intrigues. You keep them safe in your dwelling from accusing tongues." It's as if he relates to the recognition of weakness, of being overwhelmed. And David concludes with this continuing volleying between faithful declaration and questioning desperation as we read the rest of this psalm, where he says, "Praise be to the Lord, for he showed me the wonders of his love. When I was in a city under siege, in my alarm I said, I am cut off from your sight. You heard my cry for mercy when I called for help. Love the Lord, all his faithful people. The Lord preserves those who are true to him, but the proud he pays back in full. Be strong and take a heart, all you who hope in the Lord." You know, this prayer of David is often reflective of my own prayers. I don't know about you, but sometimes you feel like, I want to trust God. I want to be protected. I know that I am weak. But I also fight against these thoughts that accuse me and cause me to think, well, only if they would change, or that would change, or this would change. You know, my own lack of faith, and add on to that to the temptation just to take matters into my own hands. Maybe I'm not the only one who can feel that way. But David certainly experienced that in his own life, the cost and consequences of doing so. Finding refuge, being safe from all that happens within us and around us and to us, is not just a matter of praying or even having the specific words to pray. That might come as a little bit of a surprise to you. So then, how does all of this make sense? The answer? Jesus. Just Jesus. Jesus is the one who perfectly declares that he will trust in God and not his own feelings. In the Garden of Gethsemane, prior to his arrest, Jesus is faced with the grueling anguish within himself, knowing the torment that awaits him. His refuge is God the Father, and the submission of his own will to the overarching will of God invites us to do the same. Jesus is the one who entrusts himself to God. And as he hung on the cross, one of the final recorded phrases that Jesus exhales is, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." These are the words written by David centuries before in verse 5 of Psalm 31, which we just read, and they instruct us on at least two levels, maybe more. And one, that Jesus was familiar, he was familiar with and depended upon the words given by God in times of earthly uncertainty. And therefore, we ought to do the same. Secondly, Jesus knew that his earthly life wasn't the end of the story. God's kingdom would advance, his purposes would prevail, and Jesus was confident in the promise of eternity that God desires, that God's desire for the world, that for all the people of the world would be safe, all people everywhere, that would be fully realized. And we should likewise be continually mindful of the eternal kingdom of God. In the couple of years prior to 1854, Elisha Otis, ever the inventor, had worked on a design that incorporated a handbrake on a platform that would rise and fall. You might most familiarly recognize it. Did I say that right? I probably didn't. From watching the Wile E. Coyote chase the Roadrunner. It was similar to those used on the platforms of a railway system, except instead of being applied horizontally, it would be applied vertically. However, Elisha Otis was having a hard time convincing investors and construction contractors of this concept. It's hard to think of things that you've never seen or experienced before. But through a series of events, he was invited by P.T. Barnum, the legendary showman, to bring his invention to the exhibition fairgrounds of the New York Crystal Palace in the spring of 1854. And it was there, in New York City, where at that time few buildings exceeded 4 stories tall. Can you imagine that? It's hard to, we can't even picture that, given how iconic its skyline has become, with some of the highest concentration of skyscrapers in all the world. Yet it was there that Otis demonstrated the practicality and the safety of his platform by riding it on a pulley system, going up on a pulley system, and then bringing it down using the handbrake. Now, Otis was fully aware that the rope used to hoist the platform up could be seen as a barrier or a limitation to potential subscribers of his technology. So therefore, periodically throughout the day, he would give instructions to have the hoisting rope cut. Cut the rope, he would say, while he was on the platform at a height of about 30 or 40 feet. So that is taller than the top of that roof. And as a crowd gathered below, right where you are, the rope would be cut and gasps would be heard. Let's try that. Gasp. Okay, hang on. I'm going to cut the rope, and then you're going to gasp, okay? Hang on. All right. So he would be hoisted up to 30 or 40 feet, and crowds below would gather, and he would yell, "Cut the rope!" And then he would start to fall. No, he wouldn't. He would be unmoved because a safety mechanism would kick in. And then he could show them as he moved the brake that he could release it and come down a little at a time. He had complete control over it. He was unmoved and unaffected by the fact that the rope was cut. And each occasion as he made his way down was punctuated by the call of, this is another participatory thing. Ready? So as he comes down, he would exclaim, "All safe," and then everybody else would repeat, "All safe." Okay? So we're going to hoist him back up. Let's watch Elisha Otis go up to the top of that roof a little higher, and he's going to yell, "Cut the rope," and there'll be gasps, and down, and slowly down he comes, and he says, "All safe." Anywhere that you go in the world today, you will see the influence of Elijah Graves Otis. He only lived 5 short years after that occasion. He viewed the world of greater possibility than what he or anybody else had previously experienced. And now, anywhere that you go, you see the influence of his never give up perspective. You see the influence of his vision. You know, Jesus, as he hung on the cross facing the punishment that our lives would deserve, was similarly willing to cut the cord, so to speak. In so doing, he entrusted himself to the sovereignty of God. And though he suffered and died an unimaginable and undeserved earthly death, after 3 days, by God's incredible and infinite and eternal power, Jesus was raised from the dead. And because Jesus lives, he declares to everyone, "All safe." And we are invited to respond with, "All safe." He said, "You trust in me. You trust in God, trust also in me." He says, "Come to me." And he invites us. He says, Jesus says, "Follow me." You see, to declare our faith in Jesus Christ is to stop looking for temporary fixes or escape hatches through the seasons and circumstances of life. Pressure exposes our refuge. Pressure exposes our refuge. It is in Jesus himself where we are safe, no matter what else is going on in or around us. We all, from time to time, deal with stuff, whether that's within our thoughts or in the circumstances we face. We can too easily gravitate to what we can see, touch, and experience as an outlet when we face pressure. For some, that involves certain kinds of food. For others, it means throwing yourself more into your work. Or maybe we center ourselves trying to squeeze meaning out of relationships. Left unguarded and unfulfilled, our human nature under pressure can lead us into finding escape through harmful means, through isolation, through alcohol or drugs or inappropriate viewing online or inappropriate interactions with others. There are kids present. You fill that out. Jesus is our refuge, and he wants us to come to him, to run to him, to flee to him, to find ourselves within him. Pressure reveals where our hope and our refuge is found. We all want relief when pressure comes, but which doors are we going to go through when that happens? In one of his final conversations with the disciples, Jesus would warn them and us that as earthly time unfolds and hastens towards his return, that life would get harder. Because of the effects of evil and the consequences of sin-influenced actions generation over generation, the world would become an increasingly difficult place in which to live. Listen to these words in Matthew chapter 24, starting in verse 4. This is Jesus speaking. He says, "Watch out, so that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you're not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places, and all these are the beginning of birth pains. Then you'll be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you'll be hated. You'll be hated by all nations because of me. And at that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray, and they will hate each other. Many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And this gospel, the gospel of the kingdom, will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. And many would consider, and it would be hard to not to agree, that we are at the beginning of these birth pains. With so much access to information, we are more aware now than at any time before of the significance of the devastation that is happening to our planet and the people among whom and the people who inhabit it. These are not welcomed or brought about by God, but it does not surprise him. As a result of living in layers of bad news, Jesus gives us a commission and a responsibility to be stewards and messengers of good news to all the peoples of every nation until he returns. We need to be about this because this is God's heart for the people of this world. Jesus wants everyone to find refuge in him. He understands the apprehension with which many of us go through life. He understands our day-to-day worries and our fears regarding our own lives and the lives of those we care about. He understands our concerns for our planet as a whole. Listen to the end of Matthew chapter 23. He says, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate, for I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Jesus uses imagery repeatedly given by the prayers of the psalmists, including what we have just read in Psalm 31. He does this to communicate his desire and invitation for all to find refuge in him. Under his wings, we are protected, we are sheltered, and we are gathered. He is the one who is lifted high, exalted above everyone, above every power. He is the one who has declared, "Cut the cord," and submitted his life to the Father. He is the one who has overcome the penalty of sin and the finality of death. In our current world, where we so very easily take vertical transportation for granted, we understand the concept of entering into a small space of a net with a narrow door and being able to ascend to a higher place in safety. We don't question the working of the pulleys or the functioning of hydraulics and brake systems that move us from floor to floor at the push of a button. We accept this technology and we function according to it. In the same way, with greater eternal benefit, may we find ourselves in Jesus, trusting in him, sheltered from that which presses in on us, our fears and our worries, leaning upon his strength as we face the frailty of our earthly days and of our very lives. And may we be among those who extend this invitation to stand firm on the platform of Jesus and look forward to the day when we will all exhale, all safe, all safe. Let's pray. Jesus, you are our refuge in a world of trouble. We look for solutions in all kinds of places. And often in just the weakness of our own capacities, we turn to you last, as a last resort, as opposed to a first response. Thank you for being our first responder. Thank you for being our safety, the one in whom we can trust, for being our strength, for being our protector. God, would you forgive us for seeking help in other places? God, would you forgive the means by which we use to replace coming to you first? And for each of us, that might be a difference. Would you forgive us for the way in which we process our pressure and perhaps take it out on others? Forgive us. And Father, would you help us to understand the significance of being found safe under the wings of Jesus? May we declare that for ourselves today. Jesus, I want to be safe in you. Thank you. Thank you for hearing us. Thank you for helping us as we navigate the thoughts that go on within us. God, would your thoughts replace our thoughts as we give daily attention to you, as we commit ourselves to you. In the name of Jesus, our refuge. Amen.
Would you please stand with us as we sing the song, Where I'm Standing Now?
Hallelujah. my Savior rescued me. Hallelujah, I'm free.
Hey, it's good to be together. And thank you for making time to do that, for those of you who are here in person, and for those of you who have joined us online. If you want to learn a little bit more about Jesus, we're meeting on Wednesdays at 10:30. We're focusing our discussion on the book Jesus Centered. This week we'll be in chapters 8, 9, and 10, and would love to just connect with you further, pray about it, learn from one another, and make sure you take some time to encourage each other. And we'll have snow cones in a few minutes. But before that, let me send you off with this benediction. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will. May he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God be with you.